Quickly started and recording in progress. And I'm gonna just quickly kind of go over some ground rules for this morning and also do our land acknowledgement. Excuse me. So first of all, I'm Kim Ramsey White. I'm the Associate Dean for Inclusive Excellence here in the Gilling School of Global Public Health. For our ground rules, one, please turn off your mobile phones or at least put them on silent and do your best to refrain from texting unless you want to tweet or Facebook or something really amazing that Dr. Williams says. Please feel free to do that. Listen with your head and with your heart. Make sure there's a head and heart connection. And we do that, one, to kind of assume that people mean good. And if we could do the head and heart connection, that's what we get from that. Mistakes are a part of learning, so encourage mistakes. Assume best intentions, but attend to the impact. Be open to constructive feedback. Be patient. The session is recorded. You all just heard that part. To ask a question in the room during the Q&A, just please raise your hand. We have a microphone, and we'll bring that around. And then webinar attendees, please type your question into the Q&A box, and we have someone who is monitoring that. Just would like to do our land acknowledgement as well. North Carolina is home to the Okanichi, the Lumbee, Cahati, Haleiwa Saponi, the Eastern Band of the Cherokee, Meherrin, Saponi, Tuscarora, Waccamaw, and many other indigenous peoples. We also want to acknowledge and honor the crucial role of enslaved people in the early days of our campus. Enslaved people were sold as escheated property to help fund the establishment of UNC, and the labor of enslaved people built UNC Chapel Hill. With that, I would like to turn it over to our Dean, Dean Nancy Messonnier, for our welcome.
Thanks. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the Dean's Inclusive Excellence Lecture Series. I want to welcome our distinguished guest, Dr. David Williams. You hear more about him in a few minutes, and frankly, I think you'd rather hear from him than us, so I'm going to make this short, but just say that we are honored, actually thrilled to have him with us today. Thanks for everyone who's attending. There are 125 people who registered to attend in person and 400 who registered to attend online, so hopefully we have a big audience out there listening to us virtually. The Dean's Inclusive Excellence Lecture Series was initiated in 2019 as part of the school's Inclusive Excellence Action Plan. And the one thing I want to say is that we as a school of public health, have been and will be completely committed to the ideals of inclusive excellence and more to the journey that we are all on together to reach our inclusive excellence goals. I want to thank the Health Policy Management Department for arranging the lecture today, and specifically Dr. Weinberg and Dr. Devlin for their organization of this in collaboration with the Inclusive Excellence Unit under the, and I start to say leadership of Dr. Kim Ramsey White, but Kim doesn't like to be called the leader. She likes to be called the champion. So under the championship of Dr. Ramsey White. She's going to give a few brief remarks, and then we're going to hear an introduction from Dr. Weinberger. And then after the lecture, we will definitely have time for Q&A, we hope. So thank you again for joining us today. I'm really looking forward to this lecture. Kim?
Much like Dr. Messonnier, like, you don't need to talk to me. My office is upstairs, 207B, second floor, open door, come in anytime. But just in the interest of being able to share a few remarks, I wanted to just one say thank you to everybody for coming today and joining us for an opportunity to hear from one of the leading voices in public health and health equity. Today marks the 366th day since I got offered my position in the Gilling School of Global Public Health. As the Associate Dean for Inclusive, actually, I actually started my position in June of 2022. And while much has occurred over the last 9 months, I'm still very grateful and excited about my role, my team, my colleagues, and the opportunities to fulfill the mission of infusing inclusive excellence into all that we do and produce here in the Gillian School of Global Public Health. Our work in the Office of Inclusive Excellence is guided by the six pillars of our Inclusive Excellence Action Plan. These pillars allow the school to consider best practices and strategies for our staff, students, and faculty to thrive and excel in all aspects of their experience here at Gillings. We seek to ensure that our work stays relevant and robust by sponsoring events like this lecture series, the Minority Health Conference, which happens to be the longest running student health conference in the country, and other trainings and workshops held for the community at large, as well as our in-house community here in Gillings. Just last week, we launched the first Inclusive Excellence Survey. This will help us to reassess the goals and objectives of the action plan and examine how the community is experiencing the climate and sense of belonging that we are striving to achieve. Over the summer, we will work with our consultants, the Inclusive Excellence Council, and other constituents in the school to reassess the goals of our action plan and make updates as needed. Enough for me. Again, my office is on the second floor of this building in Rosenau. I really do have an open door policy. Would love for you to stop by. We have a new space for our students that is really, a lot of students have utilized it. It's relaxing. It's a great place to just sit and catch up if you want to read or do some work. So I hope that you'll take advantage of that as well. And with that, let me introduce Dr. Morris Weinberger, who will introduce our guest.
Thanks, Kim. So you've already heard about the Inclusive Excellence Lecture Series. Each year, one of the departments works with leadership at the school to identify a speaker for this, to invite to the series. This year, our faculty overwhelmingly chose Dr. David Williams. He is, and it's clear why we did that. He is the Norman Professor of Public Health and Chair of the Department of Social Behavioral Sciences at Harvard Chan School of Public Health. He's also Professor of African and African American Studies and Sociology at Harvard. I simply cannot imagine a more ideal person to be with us today. Dr. Williams is an internationally recognized authority in social influence on health, the author of more than 500 scientific papers. His research has enhanced our understanding of the ways in which race, socioeconomic status, stress, racism, health behavior, and religious involvement can affect health. The everyday discrimination scale that he developed is the most widely used measure of discrimination in health studies. He's examined the association between racism and health in the United States, South Africa, Australia, and Canada. He has received numerous honors and awards. He was elected to the National Academy of Medicine, the American Academy of Arts and Science, and the National Academy of Sciences. He has been ranked as the most cited Black scholar in the social sciences and one of the world's most influential scientific minds. Dr. Williams has been involved in the development of health policy at the national level in the US. He has served on federal advisory committees and on 10 committees for the National Academy of Medicine. He's testified at congressional briefings and was a key scientific advisor to the award-winning PBS film, Unnatural Causes, is Inequality Making Us Sick. Currently, he serves on the board of trustees of Robert Wood Johnson Foundation and on the Kellogg Foundation Solidarity Council on Racial Equity. He or his research has been featured in some of the nation's top print television news organizations and in his TED Talk. So with that, I am delighted to introduce Dr. Williams, who will talk to us today on understanding and effectively addressing inequalities in health. Thank you.
Thank you so very much for your kind words of introduction. He was my taxi driver yesterday who picked me up at the airport and brought me safely here. And we have been bonding since then.
And I've enjoyed my time here. It's just Southern hospitality is wonderful. And it's good to be here with you. I have a lot of territory to cover. So I'm going to jump right into my talk so that we have time for questions at the end. Racial inequities in health have existed for a long time. One indicator of that that we can track back over time is looking at life expectancy. And I'm showing you data from 1950 to 2010. Data is available over this period of time only for Blacks and whites. And you can see there was an 8-year gap in life expectancy. The average white person lived 8 years longer than the average African-American back in 1950. And by 2010, the gap has been cut to 4 years. So there's still a large gap. Four-year gap is still considerable in 2010. But there's one other thing I want you to look at. Look at the life expectancy of whites in 1950, 69.1 years on average. How long did it take for African Americans to experience the health that whites had in 1950? 1990, 40 years later, two groups living in the same society. That's the differences in health that we see. The good news in the data up through 2010 is that life expectancy has increased over time of each decade for both groups. So we're moving in the right direction. And then entered the COVID-19 pandemic. And we've seen something that we haven't seen in the United States since the early 1940s, a massive decline in life expectancy in the United States for all population groups, with the decline being largest for Latino and African-American males, of more than a 3-year decline for Black and Hispanic females, more than a 2-year decline for white males and females, more than a 1-year decline. We have not seen declines in life expectancy like that in this country since the early 1940s. And look at the impact it has had on overall life expectancy. You can see in 2020, the life expectancy for both whites and African Americans is lower than it was in 2010. And you can see that while there was a 4-year gap in life expectancy between Blacks and whites in 2010, there's now a 6-year gap in 2020, reflecting the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic. But what we want to grapple with is what drives these large racial inequities in health. I'm trained as a sociologist, and I learned sociology 101, that socioeconomic status, whether measured by income, education, occupational status, or wealth, is a central determinant of distribution of valuable resources in society, and health is one of those valuable resources. Here is a paper we published many years ago, looking at national data for the United States, life expectancy, and I'm showing you data by income here. This is all-cause mortality by income. And you can see that low-income Americans, defined here as incomes of less than $25,000 a year, household income, have an overall all-cause mortality rate that is 3 times higher than that of high-income Americans, defined as incomes above $115,000. But you could see every higher level of income is associated with a lower risk of overall mortality. And race ethnicity is strongly linked to socioeconomic status. I'll show you for one indicator, median household income in the United States, data from the US Census Bureau for 2018. I'm presenting the data in a way you can't miss the point. So I'm standardizing on the household income of whites as $1. For every dollar of household income white households receive, Asian households receive $1.23. Asian households have more persons contributed to household income. They're more likely to be multi-generational households. So if we'd use a per capita or per person measure of income, whites would have the highest income. But then let's look at the historically disadvantaged groups. For every dollar of household income white households receive in 2018, Latino households receive 73 cents, and African American and Native American households receive 59 cents. What is stunning about a 59 cents figure that is identical to the Black-white gap in income in 1978. Mm-hmm. I picked 1978 because that was the peak year of the narrowing of the Black-white gap in income as a result of the war on poverty of the 60s and 70s and the civil rights policies of the 60s and 70s. The gap was reduced to 59 cents. And in 2018, it is still 59 cents. Has it been stuck at 59 cents? All this time? No, it got worse throughout the decade of the 1980s. Reaganomics was not good to the Black community, and it was not until the mid-1990s it got back up to 59 cents, and it's a penny up and down from that every year since then. The important take-home message is we have made a lot less progress than most Americans and most of my students think we have actually made. It's a lot of talk, but actually little progress. And the large racial gaps in income markedly understate the racial gap in economic status. And what do I mean by that? Well, income captures the flow of resources into the household, but it tells us nothing about the economic reserves that households have to cushion shortfalls of income. We get that from data on wealth. And the latest data from the Federal Reserve Board on wealth, for every dollar of wealth that white households have, Black households have 10 pennies, and Latino households, hit the wrong button. Latino households have 12 pennies. So the take-home point is that when you are low in income and low in wealth, we may have all been in the same storm of the pandemic, but we're not in the same boats. And some boats are better able to weather the storm than others. When my career started, most researchers thought that the racial ethnic gaps in health were simply a function of socioeconomic status. And if you looked, for example, at Blacks and whites at the same level of income or education, race would no longer matter. We now know that life is more complicated than that. And I'm going to illustrate that with some analyses we did of national data several years ago that will illustrate both the power of socioeconomic status and the role of race and ethnicity, even when we've taken socioeconomic status into account. So this is national data for the United States, life expectancy at age 25. At age 25, the average white person will live 5 years longer than the average African-American. So there's a 5-year gap by race. But if we look within whites by education, whites with a college degree or more education will live 6.4 years longer than whites who have not finished high school. The gap within race by education is also true for income, is larger than the racial gap. And if we look within African-Americans, again, those with a college degree or more education will live 5.3 years longer than those who have not finished high school. So for both racial groups, the variation within by socioeconomic status is bigger than the racial gap. So should we abandon collecting data on race and just look at data on socioeconomic status? And I would say not so fast. Why? Because race matters at every level of socioeconomic status. White high school dropouts live on average 3.1 years longer than Black high school dropouts. And the gap actually widens as education and income increases. And here is stunning statistics, national data for the United States. The best off African Americans, those with a college degree or more education, have lower life expectancy than whites with a college degree, lower life expectancy than whites with some college, lower life expectancy than whites who have finished high school. So what do these data tell us? They tell us there's something about income and education that matters for your health, regardless of your race. But there's something else about race that matters, even after we've taken income and education into account. So why does racial inequality still exist? And what does the scientific research clearly tell us that is driving these? And what the research tells us is that racism and racial discrimination are alive, well, pervasive, and thriving in America, and actually have negative impacts on health. And I'm going to describe what I call the house that racism built and show the ways in which three mechanisms by which it affects health in contemporary society today. Importantly, I think of racism as primarily a societal system, not primarily in individuals, but primarily a social system. It's organized, it categorizes and ranks and devalues and disempowers some groups, differentially allocates opportunities and resources to groups based on an ideology of inferiority. Yes, it can lead to negative attitudes and beliefs, prejudice and stereotypes to outgroups. Yes, it can lead to differential treatment by individuals and social institutions, but fundamentally, it is a societal system. So I want to talk about how racism plays out. So first, I want to talk about structural or systemic or institutional racism. The terms have changed over time in terms of how they're used. This is a paper I published with one of my former students, Dr. Chiquita Collins, back in 2001, where we argued that residential segregation by race was a fundamental cause of racial disparities in health. And segregation refers to historic policies that determined where you could live in the United States based on your race. I would include in segregation the forced removal and relocation of indigenous peoples in the United States. And this is a book by the late John Sell. He was a faculty member, historian at Duke University. He wrote a book in 1982 about the origins of segregation in the US South and South Africa. He showed that apartheid in South Africa was an export from the US. The framers of apartheid in the early 20th century looked across the Atlantic and saw how well segregation was working in America and said, brilliant, we can implement that in our country. Importantly, Sell argues that residential segregation by race was one of the single most successful policies of the 20th century in the United States. You're saying, what does segregation have to do with anything? Well, think of segregation as a burglar at midnight. And when it shows up in a community, valuables disappear, like access to high quality schools and safe playgrounds and access to good jobs and a healthy environment and safe housing and good quality transportation and high quality medical care. Research in the United States reveals that all of these desirable resources vary by where you live, vary by your zip code, vary by your census tract, vary by your neighborhood. Powerful predictor, place is a powerful predictor of access to opportunity. Let's look at some empirical data. Two of my colleagues at Harvard, two of America's most eminent sociologists, William Julius Wilson and Robert Sampson, did a study of the 171 largest cities in the United States and said there's not even one city because of segregation where whites live in equal conditions to those of blacks. And a stunning statement, the worst urban context in which whites reside is considerably better than the average context of black communities. Now, that's a 1995 paper. So you'd say, have things gotten better? So another colleague of mine, she now was at the School of Public Health at Harvard. She's now at Brandeis University, Dolores Acevedo-Garcia. This is a 2020 paper. She has created a neighborhood opportunity index, ranking every county and smaller units as well in the United States on 29 different indicators of access to opportunity for children. And she calls it the Neighborhood Opportunity Index. And I'm just giving you some examples on the five domains that goes into this: the quality of elementary schools, the high school graduation rate, the median household income, the employment rate, the percent of people on public assistance, the quality of the air, water, soil, exposure to hazardous waste sites, resources for health like access to green space and healthy food outlets. So these are just examples of 29 indicators that goes into the Neighborhood Opportunity Index. And what does Professor Dolores Acevedo-Garcia find? If you look at the 100 largest metropolitan areas in the United States, and you ask the question, who lives in very low and low opportunity neighborhoods? 67%, two out of every three black children, 58% of Latino kids, and 53% of Native American kids live in very low or low opportunity neighborhoods compared to one in five white and Asian kids. And if you look at the opposite end, who lives in high and very high opportunity neighborhoods? Almost two thirds of white and Asian kids compared to one in five black and Latino kids. So access to opportunity at the neighborhood level varies dramatically by place in the United States and also by race. In fact, research indicates that segregation is the central driver of the racial ethnic differences in income and education and other indicators of socioeconomic status in the first place. Share with you two studies. David Cutler, one of the country's leading economists, also at Harvard University, he did a national study for the United States using fancy econometric models I cannot even fully describe, but he's able to show statistically that if you could eliminate residential segregation in the United States, you would completely erase black-white differences in income, education, and unemployment, and reduce black-white differences in single motherhood by two-thirds. All of these striking differences are linked to opportunity at the neighborhood level. One more study, one more Harvard economist, Raj Chetty. He has done an amazing intergenerational analysis using census data over multiple decades. He asked a simple question. Let's control and household income. Let's look at Black and whites at the same level of household income. So they start life at the same place. How are the children doing in the next generation? And he finds that Black boys have lower earnings than white boys in 99% of census tracts in America. Why? Because they're not working hard enough? Because they're lazy? No, they live in neighborhoods that differ in access to opportunity. Black boys do as well as white boys with neighborhoods with good resources. Just few of them are located in such neighborhoods in America. Martin Luther King, back in 1967, talked about delusional thinking. He said the majority of white Americans consider themselves sincerely committed to justice for the Negro. They believe that American society is essentially hospitable to fair play and to steady growth toward a middle-class utopia embodying racial harmony. But unfortunately, this is a fantasy of self-deception. Now, I'm just reading. I wouldn't say that myself. This is a fantasy of self-deception and comfortable vanity. Overwhelmingly, he says, America is still struggling with irresolution and contradictions. It has been sincere and even ardent in welcoming some change, but too quickly apathy and disinterest rise to the surface when the next logical steps are to be taken. We're going to come back to that when we talk about what needs to be done, but this is such a profound statement of the challenges we face in our time. What I'm showing you just by looking at one upstream mechanism of racism is that the racial inequities we see in socioeconomic status that matter for life and health do not reflect a broken system. No, they reflect a carefully crafted system functioning as planned, successfully implementing social policies, many of which are rooted in racism. They are not accidents, these inequalities, they're not random events, they're not acts of God. They are not caused by the bad choices of individuals. They illustrate powerfully the ways in which racism through upstream mechanisms have produced a truly rigged system in the United States. And what my research and that of others reveals, when you're low in economic status and you live in disadvantaged segregated neighborhoods, you have higher levels of exposure to individual stressors and greater clustering of multiple stressors, economic stressors, psychosocial stressors, and physical and chemical stressors. And all of these take a toll on your health. So I've talked about one mechanism of racism, an upstream mechanism. But let's also talk about individual discrimination, the subjective experiences of discrimination that can be an added source of stress. I developed multiple measures to assess the stress of discrimination. And one of them that was mentioned in the introduction is the everyday discrimination scale. One of my students who just did a meta-analysis of studies of everyday discrimination, I've identified a more than 460 published peer-reviewed papers from around the world using the everyday discrimination scale. Importantly, it doesn't capture all aspects of discrimination, just the little indignities, being treated with less courtesy or respect than others, receiving poorer service than others in restaurants or stores, people acting as if they're afraid of you, or if they think you are dishonest, or they think you are not smart, or if they're better than you are. Little indignities. And just to illustrate the power of everyday discrimination, I'm showcasing the work of Tenny Lewis. She was at Yale when she did this. She's now at Emory University. Each line of this study reflects a different published peer-reviewed paper, different outcome, but the predictor in all cases is everyday discrimination. High levels of everyday discrimination predicts coronary artery calcification, predicts inflammation, predicts higher blood pressure. Pregnant women who report everyday discrimination give birth to lower birth weight infants. A study of the elderly followed over time, everyday discrimination predicts more rapid declines in cognitive function. A community sample, everyday discrimination predicts poorer sleep quantity and quality. A study of adults followed over time, everyday discrimination is an independent predictor of premature death. The accumulation of those negative indignities over time literally predicts death. A study of Black and white women, everyday discrimination unrelated to subcutaneous fat, abdominal fat, but is a predictor of a dose response relationship with visceral fat, the deep internal fat within your internal organs that predicts higher risk of broad range of outcomes. Everyday discrimination predicts shorter telomere length, arterial thickness, incident cardiovascular events. And that's just an example of one researcher linking everyday discrimination to such a broad range of outcomes. And there's research that indicates there are hidden ways in which other stressors linked to race and racism adversely affect health. One study found that over 70% of Black women in America are concerned that their children might be harmed by the police. What does that anxiety do to them? This study answered it, published in 2021. It's a study of over 3,000 mothers in 20 cities and found that almost one in four urban youth are stopped by the police by the age of 15. And mothers of youth who were stopped by the police were more than twice as likely as other mothers to report depression and anxiety-related sleep difficulties. So negative consequences for the health of mothers being linked to what is happening to their children. One more study. This is a study I did with one of my former students. We linked a database that contained every police shooting in the United States. And we linked that to a database from CDC that reported on the mental health of the population in every state. And we were able to show that every police shooting of an unarmed Black person led to worse mental health, not just for the family and friends, but for the entire Black population in the state in which that shooting occurred. And the elevated risks remained elevated for 3 months, elevated mental health symptoms for 3 months. Intriguingly, it was a very specific effect. It was only police shootings of an unarmed Black person. If there was a police shooting of an armed Black person, no negative effects on mental health. And we believe that it was the perception, the fact that the person was unarmed, that there is the perception that it was unjust and unfair, but also the perception it could happen to you and to anybody else. My children, I have three daughters, they worry about me as a Black man in America. So we talked about the second mechanism. Third mechanism is racism embedded in our culture that shows up in stereotypes and stigma and implicit and explicit biases. And these stereotypes trigger racial discrimination that's had adverse negative consequences. So first of all, why do I link these stereotypes to racism? Where do these stereotypes come from? You know, scholars do some intriguing work. So a group of scholars created a database of American culture of 10 million words, and they put in it the sample of books, newspaper articles, magazine articles that the average college-educated American would read in their lifetime. What's brilliant about this? If you've put American culture into a database, you can now interrogate that database and say, when the word Black appears in American culture, what adjective most commonly occurs with Black? Poor, then violent, then religious, then lazy, then cheerful, then dangerous. When white occurs, wealthy, progressive, conventional, stubborn, successful, educated. For the fun of it, when female occurs, distant, warm, gentle, passive. Male, dominant, leader, logical, strong. If you've been raised in this society, these are associations that you have seen that have become a part of you that are deeply embedded in your subconscious and affects how you view the world. These are measures, and numbers next to those are measures of associative strength. They are not simple correlation coefficients, but you could think of them that way. If it was perfectly, the number would be one. The higher the number, the more closely tied those two concepts are. Research indicates that implicit bias exists in every sector of a society, including the healthcare system. Just 2 weeks ago, I was in Washington, D.C. To give the keynote address for unequal treatment at 20. 20 years ago, the National Academy of Medicine issued a report entitled Unequal Treatment. I was served on that committee. That report in 2003 documented pulled together the science that documented across virtually every therapeutic intervention, from the most simple, like being in a hospital emergency room with a mild TIA, mild stroke, do you get aspirin or not? Blacks are less likely to get aspirin. To the most complicated medical procedures, Blacks and other minorities receive poorer quality care and less intensive care than whites. The pattern continues. I could talk for the rest of my time with just examples of studies. I'll give you one. 2020, study of 1.8 million hospital births in Florida from 1992 to 2015. When cared for by white doctors, Black babies are three times more likely than white newborns to die in the hospital. Disparity cut in half when Black babies are cared for by a Black doctor. This study itself doesn't tell us what's driving these differences, but it suggests there is a real problem. So what can we do about all of these challenges? Number one, we need to build more health into the delivery of medical care. We need to ensure access to care for all. There's research I don't have time to review that shows for some health outcomes, we can actually eliminate the racial gaps in health just by ensuring access to care for all. Second, we need to diversify the workforce to meet the needs of all patients. Randomized controlled trial, highest quality of scientific evidence of 1,300 Black men in Northern California, given a coupon to go to a Saturday morning health clinic. When they got to the clinic, they were randomized to be treated by a Black doctor or a doctor of a different race. Men who saw a Black doctor were more likely to talk about other health problems, more likely to do the screening for diabetes, more likely to get the flu vaccine, more likely to do the screening for cholesterol. So there was much more engagement with the healthcare system when there was racial concordance. And we have in the United States a dramatic underrepresentation of minorities in the health professions. You can see the percentage, 5% of medical doctors in the US are Black, 5.8% Latino. You see similar patterns for dentists, for nurses, for pharmacists across the board. There is a lot of work to be done. So we need to increase the number of persons of underrepresented backgrounds. And how can we do this? And how can we do this differently than we have been doing it? There was a special issue of Nature magazine, scientific journal, back in 2014. And one of the studies in Nature propose new ways that we could recruit underrepresented minorities. They took the example of the success of recruiting underrepresented minorities or just people in general into PhD programs in STEM. And they showed that the PhD completion rate is only 50%, half of persons who begin, of all persons, of all racial backgrounds who begin STEM PhDs do not finish them nationally in the United States. And so they concluded that with a heavy focus on the GRE as a basis of entrance, that the GRE is no better predictor than a coin toss. And so an innovative program was developed at Fisk and Vanderbilt and the University of South Florida that decided, yes, they'd look at grades in the GRE, but it would also include skills and character attributes that are predictive of success in graduate school. And so in addition to the written information, there was a 30-minute interview about college research experiences, about key relationships, about leadership experiences, community service, life goals, and all of these are factors in prior research that have been shown to predict success in graduate school. And what they showed is that the success rate today, remember, STEM programs nationally, 50% complete. The success rate today in this program is 81%. 56 of 67 are minorities, underrepresented minorities, 35 are women. It's small numbers, but 85% of these who have successfully completed would not have met the GRE quantitative cutoff of 700. So they're suggesting that there are ways that we could do things differently that could have an impact. What else can we do? This is a study in Northern California that has an important take-home lesson, doesn't tell us how to get there. They looked at racial disparities among patients with HIV/AIDS, in the receipt of the appropriate treatment, in persons really taking the medication as they were supposed to, and in the medication actually working. And there were disparities across these three domains. And they reanalyzed the data. They had administered a 20-item cultural competence scale. And what they found was that regardless of the race of the provider, when cultural competence was high, there were no racial disparities across any of those three indicators. What did it mean to be high in cultural competence? I'm just going to show you some items from the scale. It was providers who agreed that family and friends is important to health as doctors, providers who agreed that social history contributed to how they care for their patients, providers who agreed that they were familiar with the lay beliefs their patients had, providers who said they asked their patients about the alternative therapies they use, providers who said they found out what their patients thought was the cause of their illness, providers who said they involved their patients in decisions about their healthcare. So what emerges here is a provider who respects, who engages, who talks, and under those conditions, irrespective of the race of the provider, there were in fact no racial disparities. What else do we need to do? Within the healthcare system, we need to provide care that addresses the social context. The World Health Organization asks, what do we accomplish if all we do is treat illness and send people back to live in the same conditions that made them sick in the first place? There are lots of examples right now within the healthcare system of programs that can do that. I refer you to this report from the National Academy of Medicine, Integrating Social Care into the Delivery of Healthcare, that showcases multiple solutions. But we also need to move upstream. Solving the problems in the healthcare system alone will not be enough. And we need to go upstream and implement a broad range of outcomes. We need to do what Lisa Cooper and I wrote a paper where we talk about the need to create communities of opportunity to minimize, neutralize, and dismantle the systems of racism that create inequities in health. That is, we need to enrich the quality of neighborhood environments, increase economic development in poor areas, improve housing quality and the safety of neighborhood environments. This is a paper, Williams and Cooper, International Journal of Environmental Research and Public Health, 2019. It's public access, so you can find it if you Google it. And these are the strategies we outline. Invest in early childhood. The Abecedarian Project in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, is an example of a program that took kids, poor kids at birth, put them into a program for 5 years. By age 20, those who got the program compared to the control group are doing better academically, doing better vocationally, doing less drug use, better mental health. By the mid-30s, lower risk of cardiometabolic disease linked to what kids receive birth through five. Reduce childhood poverty, enhance income and employment opportunities for youth and adults, improve neighborhood and housing conditions, enhance economic opportunities to build strong families and reduce disparities in marriage, and raise awareness levels of racial inequities. Just to give you one example, in the interest of time, improving neighborhood and housing conditions, we have good data from randomized controlled trials. If you take poor people in public housing, no health intervention, just change the neighborhood, put them in a better place to live, 10 to 15 years later, lower levels of obesity, severe obesity, and diabetes risk. And all you did was change the neighborhood. I also want to point you to the fact that there's so many examples of healthcare institutions doing very creative things, especially in the last 2 or 3 years. And I'm going to give the example of Rush University in Chicago, an academic medical center, and what they have decided to do. Rush University, in the neighborhoods in which they work, there is as much as a 10 to 12 year difference in life expectancy in some census tracts versus others. And they have made a commitment to reduce the life expectancy gap within the service area by 50% in the next 10 years. And what are they doing? They are leveraging all their economic clout to improve the economic well-being of their community. They are given an employment preference for persons who live in their local area. They are using local labor for their capital projects. They have developed career ladder programs to give people pathways to success and advancement working within their system. They have developed apprenticeship initiatives, beginning with high school students in the summer, of getting them on track for health careers. They've developed a local purchasing program. They are investing locally to improve the quality of life in the community. They're even offering financial education classes for the community and giving incentives to their employees to volunteer with local community organizations. So it's really, now we have to keep in mind, in most communities in the United States, the healthcare sector is the largest sector of the economy. And they are using all of their economic might to improve outcomes within their community. So what's holding us back? Why aren't we doing better? And what are the barriers we have to address? I would say there are three big ones linked to communication. One is, I've talked about these inequities. You saw how striking they were. National public opinion data shows that more than half of Americans do not know that racial inequities even exist. Now, we are never motivated to solve a problem that we don't know even exists. More importantly, or equally importantly, we need to develop the science base that will guide us in developing the political will. The absence of political will is a huge problem. And we know a contributor to the absence of political will is the lack of empathy. We need to find how to tell the story, narratives of the plight of the disadvantaged in a way that connects emotionally with the general public. The point of the need to build empathy is not new. W.E.B. Du Bois, a great African-American social scientist of the late 19th and early 20th century, published a book in 1899 called The Philadelphia Negro. And in that book, he has a chapter on Negro health, and he has charts showing the racial disparities in health in Philadelphia in 1899. And as he came near to the end of the chapter, he penned these words: "The most difficult social problem in the matter of Negro health is the peculiar attitude of the nation toward the well-being of the race." And Du Bois continued, "There have been few other cases in the history of civilized peoples where human suffering has been viewed with such peculiar indifference." What he calls the peculiar indifference, scholars today call the empathy gap. We have, it's documented across every continent, we feel the pain. And this is not just feeling, they've done it by looking at brain imaging data in response to someone suffering. We feel the pain of someone from our racial group compared to someone of a different racial group. On every continent has been shown in brain imaging studies. So we need to work together. We need to understand that the creation of these communities of opportunity will be beneficial to people of all races, although the rate of poverty is higher among Blacks than whites, for example. There are almost twice as many poor white people than poor Black people in America. And the policies that will address racial inequities will improve outcomes for all, including many poor and working class whites. I leave you with two quotations. Martin Luther King said, "True compassion is more than flinging a coin to a beggar, but it understands that an edifice which produces beggars needs restructuring." There are multiple edifices that are producing inequities in the United States. And finally, I leave you with the words of Robert Kennedy, speaking in South Africa in the late 1960s. He said, "Each time a man or woman stands up for an ideal or acts to improve the lot of others or strikes out against injustice, he or she sends forth a tiny ripple of hope. And those ripples can build a current which can sweep down the mightiest walls of oppression and resistance." It is my hope that each of you in this audience and online will be a tiny ripple of hope, and together we can sweep down the mighty walls of oppression and resistance. Thank you so very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Williams. I think I'll start with, well, let's see if there are any questions in the room first. Are you going to take the mic back there?
Thank you so much for your talk. I really enjoyed all the research that you conducted in the comment on empathy, and I'm wondering specifically about your the research regarding cultural competence and how it impacts care delivery and care receipt for physicians. And I'm wondering what how do you get someone to experience that empathy if they don't have it? And then if someone does have that empathy, like the physician, what are the systemic ways that our healthcare system impacts that empathy from getting into the way that physicians provide care?
Those are all very good questions. I wish I had the answers. This study didn't tell us how you get cultural competence. It just had a cultural competence scale, and it's a 20-item scale, and I picked 6 items to give you a sense of what kinds of characteristics emerge from that. So this study doesn't tell us how to get there, but it shows us what kinds of attitudes make a difference. So there are many cultural competence programs in the country. I'm not sure. I don't know that all of them are very effective. Many cultural competence programs help you to understand that Koreans are like this and Native Americans are like this. And those can actually reinforce negative stereotype and encourage stereotypic thinking, as opposed to helping you to understand who this person is, where they're coming from. And you could see some of the questions that those providers ask about asking people what they thought was important, what they thought was the drivers of the illness. So it showed a level of respect for the patient, a level of learning from the patient and working as a partner with the patient. So it does give us some ideas of what we need to be, but I don't know of any specific program that does that. But let me mention one other thing. There are many programs in academia, in Fortune 500 companies, in healthcare institutions that focus on implicit bias training. There is research that shows that the implicit bias training programs that are offered by these organizations do not work. They work to raise awareness that implicit bias exists. They do not work to reduce either implicit or explicit biases. There are wonderful reviews of the literature. There's a meta-analysis of 900 studies that shows they have little impact on reducing implicit bias, although they're useful in raising awareness. I often talk about the divine solution. Professor Patricia Devine at the University of Wisconsin-Madison has developed an implicit bias program that works to reduce implicit bias, with the effects being evident 3 months later. What is different about her program? It's not a 2-hour workshop. It's a 10-week program with people going once a week for 10 weeks with homework exercises and practice exercises that implements a number of strategies shown to be effective out of cognitive psychology, and that makes a difference. So again, there are examples of things that might work, but there's still much that we need to learn.
Thank you.
I'm gonna take one question that we had presented before, and then we'll get this gentleman right here. North Carolina recently just expanded Medicaid in the state legislature. What effects do you predict this movement will have on health equity in North Carolina? And has it improved health equity in other states that have already expanded Medicaid?
I would say to the questioner, go to the Commonwealth Fund's website. There is actually a wonderful article about the impact of increasing Medicaid on facilitating health equity, of reducing gaps in terms of access, but even in terms of outcomes. There's a wonderful article on the Commonwealth Fund website about the impact. So what's it going to do? Is it a positive thing? Yes, it is. Is it a magical thing that will solve all the problems? No. Let me just give another comment. We talked about COVID-19 and its impact on racial inequities, and what studies showed in the early first year of COVID-19, the death rate for African-Americans, for Latinos, for Native Americans, for Native Hawaiians and other Pacific Islanders were 2 to 2.6 times higher from COVID-19 compared to whites. In the United Kingdom, where everyone has access to healthcare through the National Health Service, the death rate for Blacks compared to whites in the first year of the COVID pandemic was 4 times higher, age-adjusted death rate. For Bangladeshi Pakistani, 3.5 times higher. For Indians, twice as high. So again, I want to make the point that it's just healthcare alone is not going to solve the problem. We also have to think of the factors outside the healthcare system. And so showcasing an example of another society where everyone has access to healthcare and the disparities were even larger than in the US.
Gentlemen.
Hey, Dr. Williams, thank you so much for speaking and sharing your research. I was really interested in the everyday discrimination scale. Can you talk more about like the applications of the scale, and are you still asking general questions, or could it be adapted for in a medical setting? Like, could you have like clinician specific questions to assess everyday discrimination there?
I haven't done the work, but there are two published adaptations of the scale to the healthcare context. If you go to my Scholar website, there is a link and a measure and discrimination resource, and there are multiple papers referenced, but we cite those two studies. Importantly, the scale asks these global questions. At the end, we ask, what do you think was the main reason for it? So it doesn't only capture racial discrimination, it captures discrimination for any reason that individuals will have. What we have found so far that the attribution, the reason you have the discrimination, does not seem to matter in terms of impact. So whether you report discrimination was based on race or based on your gender, the effects are the same. There is some research, not many, just about three studies published, that have looked for individuals who report discrimination for multiple factors, and there does seem to be a dose-response relationship if you're saying you are being treated in these ways for multiple reasons. But the specific attribution doesn't matter, and there are adaptations that I didn't do, but to the healthcare context.
Thank you for the wonderful talk and sort of thought-provoking questions. In our country, we seem to have this habit of focusing on race when there's a horrific incident that happens, like George Floyd. And there's a discussion about racial reckoning and a lot of enthusiasm. And then it seems like instantly it fades from our memory until the next horrible event when somehow we rediscover it. I wondered if you could talk a little bit more about your thoughts about that. And also, are you pessimistic, optimistic that there is change coming?
Can we get back to Dr. Williams' presentation? I want to go back to your Martin Luther King quote. To address Dr. Just leave it there so people can see it while you answer that.
Yes. So let me talk to it's a code that's way, way back. Am I optimistic or pessimistic? In general, I'm an optimist. I believe that we can do better. I believe that we have to do better. So in general, I am an optimist. To be honest with you, as I see what's happening in the state of Florida and Texas and so on, it's difficult to be optimistic. The turn that is taking place at the level of some states is very disconcerting on the one hand. I still think that there still is a lot of ignorance, and many people are just unaware of the realities, and there are so many false narratives out there about what the reality is. So I think there are people of goodwill who are really sincere, but who have been sold a bill of goods that's false. I do think that one of the things we need to do when I talk about the need to build empathy, and I talk about the need, the narrative. I would recommend for persons who want to look at this more closely. There's an organization in Washington, D.C. called the Frameworks Institute. This specializes in doing work on communication and how to talk about different topics. And there is a issue brief that they issued more than 10 years ago on talking about race. I was in a meeting with the head of Frameworks Institute recently, and I told him he needs to update that, you know, and he says, yes, he said, we've got a lot of data that we could now update that. Basically what they show is that the way most advocates of racial equity talk about race do not break through the dominant frameworks that most Americans have. And then they point to alternative ways in which you could talk about race that would be effective in breaking through the dominant frameworks. I don't have time to fully elaborate on the topic, but Frameworks Institute issue brief on how to talk about race is a useful resource to begin. And more powerfully is, I talk about the need for persons interested in health equity to do more work with health communication experts like Frameworks Institute, because how we talk about these issues matters, and to do more work with political scientists, because we need to learn how to be more effective in trying to build the political will so that we can have sustained change. So those are two of the important issues. And let me just illustrate that. There was a study published in Science of reducing an intervention that reduced discrimination against transgender individuals, got people, a 15-minute intervention, got people to vote for this transgender initiative and reduce their prejudices against transgender individuals. Wonderful. Just lay workers, they got and went in knocking on doors, and this worked, and the reduction of prejudice towards transgender individuals was evident 3 months later. But this was the mind-blowing thought. There was a commentary published with that study that said the researchers who did that tested 10,000 canvassing conversations before they came up with the one that worked. And I can't even wrap my head around 10,000 canvassing conversations to come up with the one that worked. But it suggests the kind of work and effort we need to do in terms of trying to tell the story in a way that emotionally connects with individuals.
I know. We still got more we want to talk about. Can we take one more question and then we will? We got one on the webinar that we should.
Yes, we have about eight of them, actually.
That's big one. Big one.
Okay. I'll say, I think this one's a really important one to address. So an anonymous attendee says, do you think that lowering standards to enter graduate programs or other programs says people of color do not have the skills and abilities to achieve is also another form of racism?
Really, really important question. I don't believe we should lower standards. What I think the Nature article that I talked about was using as criteria for admission the factors that predict success in graduate school. I have data from the American Association of Medical Colleges of the relationship between MCAT scores and success in completing medical school. And there isn't a straight line relationship. It's a threshold effect. Once you get above a certain threshold, which then there is no difference in success and completion. And we also have to realize is that the criteria that we often use, we need to do not necessarily reflect the native ability of individuals, but they affect what people have been exposed to. I have a slide I didn't show when I usually talk about how socioeconomic status predicts virtually every desirable resource in society. I have a slide that shows national data for the United States, SAT scores by family income. Every $10,000 increase in income in the United States is associated with a higher SAT score. So what does the score capture? It captures what people have been exposed to. And so we need to think of what we do to give students. Of course, we want competent people in every profession. We want people who are prepared to be successful. And so we need to think of the investments we need to make to ensure that everyone has the adequate background and preparation. But also, the Nature article was saying, build into the admissions process those factors that predict success.
Dr. Williams, thank you so very much. We're like almost 10 minutes over our time.
We appreciate all that you have done very much. Thank you for being here. Please join us in the atrium for a reception with Dr. Williams.
Well,
you
know, I'll say,
Thank you so much. I'm going to go back to the stand. Good evening.